Hello and welcome back to Squealing Pig Guitars. My name's Jack and this is a One Take Wonder Ben.
And today we're going to be bringing you episode 4 of the Guitar Haul, where we look at all the stock we have bought this week, or as I must say, Jack has hunted down like a beast. Yeah. You can see over here, we've got so many guitars, lots of Gibson, Fender, Gretsch even. Lots of awesome guitars. You got anything more to say about these before we get started?
No, again, we've just got quite a few unique guitars there as well, but some normal ones that we normally get in. But yeah, I just want to say thanks for everyone who's watched our videos also. We've had some great feedback. We're going to try and get a few more videos out each week now to talk about and display all the new guitars that we've got in and just go into a bit more detail about them. But anyway, let's crack on. Let's open these bad boys up. Go on, Benjamin, first.
This is the first guitar.
People call you Benjamin.
No, they don't. My name's Benjamin. But yeah, so this is the first guitar, and this one is probably my favourite. It's an R9, but it's a weird one. It's got a quilt top, and you don't see these very often, even though we do actually coincidentally have two in the showroom. But then we're just flexing there, aren't we? But yeah, this is a really nice burst, as you can see. This is from, what was it, 2006?
I think it's 2006 model, this one.
And I've been told it's unplayed, so it's in great condition. I think it was VOS initially, though, so there is a little bit of like a waxy kind of build-up as such on the guitar.
A little bit, yeah. It's a little bit like the finish is naturally dehazed somewhat.
And you can see on the hardware, it's slightly aged. But yeah, this is just a great example, very, very clean. Has all the kind of specs you just imagine from an R9. Quite a small neck on this one.
It's got that original hefty red certificate as well. All the unopened case candies in there as well, including the strap and other bits of paperwork as well. Yeah. You've got this cool sort of like purple line lifting case. Yeah, everything's in there from new. Real collector's piece, this one.
I've never seen an R9 like this, so if you want to be a cool cat and have a different one to everyone else, get this one, yeah. So this is the first Gibson case that doesn't break your back, because this one is an ES Les Paul. Again, very rare, just like everything we have here. But as you can see, we've got a pretty stunning gold top. So this is kind of like a 54 reissue. If you think about it, you've got like a wrap tailpiece and TP90s. Through Way Selector, but these Les Paul's ES models are very weird and rare because they've got a drop top, like a flat top, or it's at least less curved than a normal Les Paul. So normally you'd get like the kind of arch top. Whereas this is very flat, and as you can see, it's hollow with a center block, is it?
Yeah, it's got a center block in it. It's sandwiched between poplar, so you've got poplar on the side, and then you've got two bits of maple.
Yeah, and you can see it's actually a translucent back, so you can see all the grain there. But yeah, this is very unique, very light, completely out of tune, but an awesome guitar.
So next up, we've got another fan favorite. If you watched last week's video, we know you'll know that we have one of these in last week. Fortunate enough to get another one in. So this is a Fender Plus this time. Last week we had a Fender Plus Deluxe. This week we've got a Fender Plus in a nice three-tone burst there. Now this one is in, I wouldn't say immaculate condition, I'd say excellent condition. The one we had last week was pretty damn mint, and this isn't far off. It's got one little tiny nick there, but it's all original. You've got three gold lace sensors on this one, making this a Fender Plus. And you've also got a trem setter behind the back plate there also, which is a nice, I mean, Fender Pluses usually come with the trem setters anyway, but this one's got it in because a lot of time they were taken out. But yeah, this one's all original case. Unfortunately, this one, you haven't got any original paperwork, but still a nice guitar. There'd be quite a few people that would want one of these, so.
Okay, so this is pretty rare for us. We have a Gretsch, and this is a signature model of one of my favorite rockabilly artists of all time. It's Brian Setzer. And if you are well educated in rockabilly music, you'll know he's the lead singer and guitar player of Stray Kratz, and he's also done lots of solo work. This one's such a naughty guitar, just look at that. Sparkle everywhere. So it's a very understated guitar, as you can tell. And you've actually got Brian Setzer's signature here. That's not a real signature, it's just obviously to show it's a signature guitar. In terms of condition, it's very mint, very good condition, as you would want this kind of finish to be in. You've got some cool TV Jones pickups, which are like the best part of these Gretsch guitars.
Yeah,
sound really good, kind of like low output humbuckers. And one master volume and a three-way switch, so you can just be as cool as you want to be. Look, what do you think, Jack?
Suits me better, I think.
I think it's...
You look at yourself as well.
Streak out. Yeah, but yeah, if you want to hold your guitar in an acoustic case, it's awesome. But yeah, if you get a view around here, You'll see this sparkles really nicely.
This as well is one of the more well-known guitar brands which have been like building guitars for a long time as well. I think Gretsch started building guitars in the late 1880s. So they do go way back. And Brian Setzer, in the early days, used to play a 1620, and I think they started building in these hot rods around 1999, and they've been going well ever since, so.
Yeah, I think these are like built off like their modern day kind of Electromatic, right?
Yeah.
Very, very big bodies, good jazz box guitar. But yeah, these play great. Okay, so we've got another guitar. We've got a Fender Custom Shop this time. And yeah, so what's this one called, Jack?
So yeah, this is a 1955 Fender Custom Shop Dual Mag. Dual mag refers to the pickups, doesn't it, Ben?
Yeah, you've got two types of magnet in it. Obviously, the whole pieces are where the magnets are, so you've got like an Alnico 2 on one side and an Alnico 5 on the other side. Basically, it just means that the response across the strings is more even. Obviously, the lower strings will create more output than the higher strings, so it makes it a little more compressed. I'm not sure which one it would be. I imagine it's Alnico 2, it'll be less output, or it'll have a tonal feature that'll be better for bass.
Right,
and then
okay.
As you go higher, I think it'll be 3 and 3.
Yeah.
But other than that, it's a pretty standard guitar. Obviously, 5-way blade, 2 tones, 1 volume. Lovely aged maple neck, because it's a 55, 56. Yeah. So you've got quite a big neck on there as well.
Yeah.
And as you can see there, extra cool points, it's a limited edition.
Yeah. This actually came in on a trade. I haven't properly looked into this guitar yet, so I'm quite interested because it's the first time I've had a dual mag in, but yeah, it does look really nice. There's a lot of really nice checking on the back there. I don't know if you can see it.
Yeah, that's one of the best ones I've seen. You also can see the, I presume this is ash, right?
Yeah,
ash. You can see like the divots, like the grain of the wood.
Right, it's sank
very,
in,
it's
yeah.
Very impressive. I've just been playing that one as well. It's a beautiful sounding guitar.
Yeah.
Very,
it looks, it's actually, I think it's listed as Candy Apple Red, but it looks more like a tangerine in person.
Yeah, slightly.
But nevertheless, it's a nice finish.
Yeah,
It's got a compound radius neck as well, has it? Or?
Yeah, compound radius 7.25 to 9.5.
Yeah.
So, very cool. And you see, we've got all the paperwork. This price is pretty new, right? Or is it?
Yeah, it's 2019?
Yeah,
so it's fairly new. Journeyman relic finish as well, so it's not heavily relict, which I prefer on these sort of like candy metallic type finishes. When it's a bit over-relicked on that style of finish, it doesn't look right in my opinion.
Hey, so this one, again, is extremely cool. We've got a Paisley Stratocaster, which is from the Custom Shop, and this is from the Wildwood 10 kind of collection. So if you don't know, Wildwood is obviously a dealer in California. They're kind of renowned for having some really cool guitars, right, on the custom order. So as you can see from this one, you've got an awesome relic finish on this awesome paisley colour. It's got a nice cool 70s headstock, or late 60s, however you want to see it. But yeah, it's just a really cool guitar, kind of standard other than that, but just a really nice built Strat. Have you got anything else to add on this?
Did you say you've got John Cruise pickups in this one?
I haven't, no.
You don't know?
No, it does.
Oh, it does, that was John Cruise pickups.
I haven't said that though.
Yeah, but we've had a few Wildwood 10 Fender Custom Shop guitars in from Wildwood. Essentially what it means is they've been sort of the specs hand-picked by them, so it's not a regular production Fender Custom Shop model, so this is probably like one of 20, one of 15 that they've had built for the shop, so it's quite a unique guitar. We didn't import it from America, this actually came in at a trade-in, but it's always hard to judge the condition of a relic, but this one's, judging by the frets and stuff, hasn't seen a great deal of play. So yeah, really nice example.
And it's cool to see one in the custom shop, because there was like a run in the 90s where they're only made in Japan.
Yeah,
I think this is kind of what that's modeled off slightly.
Yeah.
Obviously being custom shop though, so you get the playability and the craftsmanship from the custom shop. And then we've got all the paperwork here, the floor traveler and the certificate. Fortunately, no leather bound case though, so that's sad.
Edition. Don't normally get a lot of 335s in. I'm quite picky about 335s. There's quite a few of you that will probably argue with me on this, but I'm not a fan of the new Memphis-made 335s. If I do find a 335, it's got to be Nashville. And this is an early Nashville 335 in a walnut finish, gold bar hardware. Now, the walnut finish, I think they only produced for a few years for the 335 in the early 90s. And this is a really nice example. I've had a couple of these over the past couple of years. But yeah, nice to finally get another one back in. It's got a nice flame top as well. You've got one piece top and back.
Yeah. It's quite interesting because obviously they're not like reissues, so they're not like historically accurate. So you do have quite a thin neck on these, and the headstocks like are different to like the normal 335s that you find in like whenever they were produced. I'm actually not too sure.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's a really cool guitar. I mean, if you look, there is some aging on the hardware just from playing wear, really. And I think this top really kind of speaks in, you know, that downward angle there on the maple. But yeah, really cool guitar. I'm sure it's very resonant.
Yeah.
Can confirm it's very resonant.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's the Walnut 335. Is that from the 90s as well?
No, this is I think it's a 2001, 2000.
We've got another extremely exciting one. So this is a Paul Reed Smith, Paul's guitar. So this is obviously signature model of the owner of PRS, Paul Reed Smith. And as you can see, this is like one of my favorite PRS designs, to be honest, because you have the TCI pickups with the 408 system. So you're able to individually have the bass and the treble pickup in humbucker mode or single coil mode. And these, I'm not sure completely, but basically when they have the single coil, I wouldn't know the physics behind it, but it actually stays the same volume because it adds whines to the pickup. So they're very like true sounding single coils. And as you can see by this one, it's a beautiful top. Got like a maple tight, like a flame type top, but it's got quite a lot of cross figuring in it. So it almost just looks like a pool, nice for the summer holidays.
It's quite a nice lot of depth in it as well. Like you'll find with the blue fade finishes, it really does like, I don't know what it is, but it tends to show the wood grain a little bit better than the other colors.
Yeah.
But I saw a few pictures of this online before I bought it, and I wasn't too sure how the flame would look in person, but when it came, it actually looked really nice. It was quite a nice surprise.
What's also really cool about this is that you have a nice kind of streaky, almost like Indian, is it Indian rosewood? It looks almost like a little bit Brazilian.
It's a fairly new one, so I don't think, it'd probably be Palfara or a different type of rosewood.
I was gonna say it looks quite light, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But yeah, we've got brushstroke birds, which is quite rare on these. It's not, though, it's like a Paul Reed Smith model kind of feature, and a nice matching head cap with ivory tuners. Mm. But yeah, these just play great. Nice, lightweight guitars. As I said, one of the best models from PRS, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Versatile guitar, some really cool pickup options here. That was running through the Behrman, so quite a clean amplifier, but it really kind of pokes the amp on them humbucker tones. But yeah, cool. Probably cut that last bit out, but yeah. Got so many.
Okay guys, so another Gibson custom one here. This one's gonna divide the crowds. Not everyone's gonna like this, but just give it a chance. It's a nice guitar. So we've got a Les Paul Axis. As you can see, we have a Floyd Rose, which is, I guess, scandalous for a Les Paul, but it's a very efficient and kind of, you know, modern guitar. So the cool things about this is they kind of approached all of the design flaws of a Les Paul, right? So this is, you know, it's a thinner body, so it's not as heavy. You've got like kind of cutaways here for your belly, or I don't know, whatever else that might be there. Got a recessed heel cut, and it goes straight into that lovely neck. So this is like a nice black finish. It's kind of reminiscent of Alex Lifeson's guitar from Rush. He had a Les Paul Classic, which was retrofitted with a Floyd Rose. So I think that's kind of where they came from. But yeah, it's a very unique Les Paul. It doesn't really play like a Les Paul, if you know what I mean. Like, obviously with the cutaway and stuff, it's a very different animal, but definitely one to check out if you want something a bit different. Completely gunmetal. It's a gunmetal finish with quite a light rosewood board. And the condition's really good, actually. It doesn't really look like it's been played very often. But you can own it and play it as much as you want.
The one thing I will add about this guitar as well, which I quite like, I know you mentioned the fretboard. It's got like a really nice This actually again came to us as a trade-in, but the original owner was talking to me about the fretboard on this, and it's got like a nice streak that you probably only usually find in like Zerocote rosewood that they use. So yeah, it's got quite a nice, unique fretboard, this one. And like Ben said, it's like even though it does look black, the official colour is gunmetal grey.
So yeah, I mean, obviously these are very rare guitars in the sense of like production numbers. Obviously they've come in multiple different colours. But just remember that these kind of models that are like hated by the traditionalists sometimes go up in value quite a lot. So it could be a good investment for you if you're looking to get a rare model. Other kind of, I guess, like kind of unique features of this Les Paul is that we do have a tap, so like a push pull pot, which I presume is, you know, just normal coil splitting.
So yeah, you've got, because it's an early model, you have got like the early sort of like style Gibson hard case.
Yeah.
It's really good condition as well, so I would say it's collector's material if you're looking to obviously get one of these. This is a Fender made in Japan, offset Telecaster. Now, I didn't know anything about this guitar until it came to my hands and I've done a bit of research. But it's actually, you could probably tell that the wood looks quite unusual. And this is actually all made of carina. So you've got, even though it looks like a one piece, it's actually two bits of carina there. The colour's like quite yellow, quite vibrant in person. And only 120 of these were made for our region. So it's quite a rare guitar, not many about on the market. I've certainly never seen one. And I also think that they produced an earlier American vintage version, like a vintage reissue version, around about 2016, which didn't do too well. So this is sort of mimed off that, really, I think. But it's really heavy. It's got a really nice sort of yellow tinge to it. Sounds great. Yeah, quite unusual guitar, this. So this will be going on our website soon. It's got a Fender Jazzmaster hard case, so obviously it would have been a made in Japan guitar, it would have come with a soft case, but it's been upgraded with a Fender sort of Telex case, and it's all fitted. So thanks for watching our guitar haul video. I've had a lot of fun talking about these interesting guitars that we've got coming this week. They should be on our website shortly, so if you're interested, get in touch. If you've got any questions, also give me a call, get in touch, send me an email, whatever you want to do. Also, if you've enjoyed watching these videos, please like and subscribe.
Yeah, make sure to watch out for our Instagram reels as well. We'll be demoing some of these guitars in them Instagram clips, as well as those We Love episodes as well on here on YouTube. But yeah, as always guys, thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next video. From me and Jack here at Squealing Pig, rock on.